All right, it's a good time to start. So this is the afternoon session. The first speaker is John Van Noort, the structure of chromatin, single molecule experiments on model fibers and real genes.
All right, thank you for the introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here again in Singapore. These are Dutch tulips now. Here we go. So I'm going to talk about chromatin and the mechanical properties of these fibers, realizing that chromatin is, say, one big polyelectrolyte with lots of charges around. I'm going to ignore most of it and just see at the empirical observations of it. Just to make things clear, these are all the salt conditions that we work in our chromatin fibers. And this is the experiment that I'm going to talk most about. So it's a single molecule pooling experiment with magnetic tweezers, basically a small bead, about 1 micron in size, so smaller than the nucleus of a cell, and a single chromatin fiber that's hooked up to it. And basically what we're going to do is pull on the bead and then measure the extension of the chromatin fiber. Now I said I'm going to ignore all the polyelectrolyte properties of the DNA and the chromatin. It's all sort of included in the mechanical model for DNA, a worm-like chain. And if you pull on DNA, basically you stretch out all the curvature here, you get this typical curve that can be captured in a so-called worm-like chain, already by John Marco in the 90s, which basically captures the balance between the tendency to become a random coil and the tendency to be straightened out. Right, and this is all old news. When you fit this simple model to the experimental data, there's only two parameters that you need to worry about. That's the contour length of the DNA and the persistence length, which happens to be 50 nanometers. Now, 50 nanometers is an important number in chromatin because it's exactly the amount of DNA that's wrapped within a single nucleosome. Right? The persistence length is sort of the length over which the DNA is straight, so this should be a snapshot of a typical conformation of DNA, and it's all wrapped into this very tightly wrapped structure. That's all electrostatics, right? Of course, that's relevant for the biology, and we'd like to think of chromatin now as a huge transcription factor. It sort of modulates the activity of certain genes by opening and closing the chromatin. And these are typical cartoons that you can find in literature that as genes are transcribed, the chromatin needs to open up by various modes here. That's how we tend to think of chromatin and its structure and how it relates to transcription. I find this a very interesting experiment by my friend and colleague Michael Poirier, who did look at the accessibility of DNA in chromatin fibers. And he compared that to the accessibility of DNA in a single nucleosome. And you would expect that when you look at the accessibility as by restriction enzyme access, that these condensed fibers, that they basically restrict the access to the DNA. Well, not so. He found that there can be up to 8-fold increase in accessibility as measured by restriction enzymes when you fold a nucleosome into a fiber as compared to a mononucleosome. I find that intriguing, and that's what we are going to head towards. This is another type of experiment that we typically do, and I want to show this to show that this is really a dynamic system. So we can reconstitute nucleosomes on DNA, on special DNA containing a special sequence, a 601 sequence found by John Widom. It's a non-natural sequence, but it's very good in positioning these histone proteins exactly at the right location on the DNA. Okay, and when we do so, we can introduce FRET labels in the DNA and reconstitute the nucleosomes, and basically we get orange nucleosomes from green DNA because the distance between these two labels decreases from 25 nanometers here to a couple of nanometers in the folded nucleosome. Okay, now why is this relevant? If you look in time to a single folded nucleosome, you can see dynamics like this, and it's sort of traffic light behavior. Usually the traffic light is on red, and every now and then it turns green. These excursions here. And that's where the nucleosome spontaneously opens up. It sort of breathes, right? So this rather stiff DNA is wrapped around the histone core, but every now and then it unwraps a little bit and then rewraps again. And you can just measure the timing of it. So it opens for about 25 milliseconds and closes then for 280 milliseconds. That means that about 10% of the time the nucleosome is open. And it opens and closes about 10 times a second. So it's really a dynamic thing. It's not a fixed structure. We can also observe the same thing with our pooling experiment. So remember the bead and the DNA molecule that we pull on. And now we put a single nucleosome on the DNA. And you can see actually that there's two transitions going on. So the most right gray dotted line is what DNA would behave like. And there's basically a little bit of condensation. This is about 50 nanometers. And you can see that the nucleosome unwraps in two steps, here at 2.5 piconewtons and here at about 10 piconewtons. And in both cases, you gain about 25 nanometers of contour length. Okay. Here we can do the same dynamics by just stopping here at 2.5 piconewtons. And then look what happens in time, and you can see the same digital behavior. Nucleosomes open, nucleosomes closed, nucleosomes open, nucleosomes closed, nucleosomes open. And you can just do the timing again. And as force increases, the open structure is stabilized, and the closed one is destabilized, as in the lifetimes of these structures. Okay? So this is sort of the starting picture of how our chromatin fiber is built up. It's built up of single nucleosomes that behave like this, right? And this is summarizing the behavior of a nucleosome. So in two steps, you open up the nucleosome into something that's fully unfolded. Of course, a single nucleosome is a poor excuse for the chromatin in our cells, right? These are highly charged. There's lots of interactions with other nucleosomes. So we'd like to go to more relevant chromatin fibers. And this is the first big step. Add a single nucleosome to the one that we're probing, right? So here we make a fiber of two nucleosomes. And when you do that and look at the dynamics of the DNA within the nucleosome, there's not much changing. Okay, well, that was a bit annoying. It became more interesting when we increased the length of DNA between the nucleosomes from 50 base pairs to 55 base pairs. And now suddenly this nucleosome is open twice as often as the single nucleosome. So there must be interactions between these two nucleosomes. However, the distance is too big for electrostatics or for the histone tails to interact like this, meaning that the distance between these two nucleosomes should be smaller. Now, we can also put the nucleosome on the other side, and then basically you see the opposite effects, as well as a general tendency to be more open, and that's because here the two DNA strands come really close together and they repel each other. Okay, so this makes a more open nucleosome. You can also close the nucleosome, making the linker length shorter, 20 base pairs, and then basically we get less breathing of the DNA within the nucleosome. But still, two nucleosomes is a poor model for a chromatin fiber, right? And chromatin fibers, there's lots of discussion about it still even. They fold into 30 nanometer fibers. And how that's exactly folded, there's lots of discussion. There's on the one side, there's the zigzag structure. So the DNA zigzags from nucleosome 1 to 2 and 2 to 3, 4, 5. And basically, the odd and the even nucleosomes are stacked on top of each other, which would be at odds with a solenoidal model where neighboring nucleosomes stack on top of each other and fold into a fiber with a diameter of about 30 nanometers. And this was work by Daniela Rhodes. Now, of course, here in these images, you can't really see the linker DNA. So you have to deduce it indirectly from the diameter of the fiber, as Daniela did. I'd like to point out that nucleosomes like to stack. If you just cut the linker DNA, they just stack on top of each other. And that's basically what sort of organizes these nucleosomes in a fiber. Now we make, with the help of Daniela Rhodes, we make beautiful fibers where the nucleosome positions are perfectly arranged using, again, the 601 sequence. So we get very regular fibers. And then when we pull on them, I would expect that we add one more level of complication. That is that these nucleosomes would stack. And as we pull on them, that we go through this mechanism in a serial fashion. That's not what we found. What we found was that these stacked nucleosomes, they unstack and then directly form a nucleosome structure with already 60 base pairs unwrapped, right? And then we can gradually unwrap it more by pooling. And these are the data. So here there's two curves, a red one and a green one. They're basically the same except for the distance between the nucleosomes. So in the red case, there's 20 base pairs of linker DNA between the nucleosomes, which is the average linker length of yeast. And in green, there's 50 base pairs of linker DNA, which is the average linker length for human chromatin. And you can see, well, if you go to very high forces, the DNA melts. If you go to forces over 10 piconewtons, we can see these steps of the last turn unwrapping of the DNA. But this is really where the higher order structure of the chromatin fiber unfolds at forces below 10 piconewtons. And if you zoom in there, you get these very well-defined curves. And we've done by now thousands of these curves, and they all look alike. Right, it's really remarkable. You can also see that depending on the linker length or the nucleosome repeat length, NRL here, that we get a different type of structure. Now, we quantified these fibers in, say, models that are drawn here by these black lines, and I want to walk you through this a little bit. So when we have these four conformations, these three structures, the extension is just dependent on the amount of free DNA, which increases as you unwrap more free DNA. So the force extension curve just follows a worm-like chain that has a contour length that represents the amount of free DNA. And we can just integrate it over force, and then we get the work to get into these structures. For the fiber, we have an even more simple structure. And without going into the formula, I can also graphically represented by an energy diagram that each of these structures can be stretched, increasing the energy, following the formulas that I just showed you. And we can just calculate the average extension averaged over these four structures, and then increase the force. And when we increase the force, basically these energy curves, they are tilted. And at some point here, the green curve is slightly lower than the blue one. So this structure is favored, and we can go through force like this, and here at forces close to 10 piconewtons, we're just like there. Okay, so this simple model can basically describe all our curves. So these are 10 different fibers here, and the main difference here at lower force is that some of these fibers contain not nucleosomes, but tetrosomes, so only containing one winding of DNA. In view of time, I won't go through the details there. This is the last turn unwrapping, and here you can just see a regular staircase without averaging. So these dots are real data. Without averaging, you can just make out the number of nucleosomes here, 17 in this case. And each step is about the same size. Let me skip these slides for a moment. Let's go back to these curves that really tell you about the higher order folding of these curves, of these fibers. So when we have these models, we can extract the numbers, and one of them is the stiffness of the fiber, right? How much force does it take to stretch it a certain amount? Now, what you can directly notice for the 20 base pairs of linker DNA, that the curve is much steeper, right? It takes more force to stretch it. Actually, it's almost four times as stiff. What you cannot directly deduce, but indirectly, you can look at the maximum extension before rupturing. For the red curve, it's half, it's 5 nanometers as compared to 10 nanometers for the green curve. Interaction energy that we fit is the same, and there's a qualitative difference between these curves. That is, here you see a rupture in one go, so there's a cooperative rupture event. Well, here there's a gradual rupture, right? So each nucleosome stack, pair of stacking can rupture independently. Now, all these observations are consistent with a different folding for these fibers. So for the green one, there's a neighbor-neighbor interaction, so a solenoidal folding. While for the red one, it's zigzag. Because if you have zigzag as compared to a solenoid, basically we have a stretch of, well, we have half the length of our chromatin fiber, becomes two times stiffer, and we have two of them in parallel. That's another two times. So we expect a four times stiffer fiber here. Per nucleosome, you can get only half the maximum extension. And 10 nanometers per nucleosome, that's about the height of the nucleosome, 6 nanometers, plus the length of one of the tails of the nucleosomes that are thought to mediate the stacking. Okay? And of course, if you want to rupture here, the outside nucleosomes, they're much more vulnerable to force than the inside ones, making this transition cooperative, while here each and every nucleosome stacking is basically the same. Okay, so linker length determines chromatin fiber folding, and we're now in the process to go through different linker lengths and find different foldings. How much of this is electrostatics? Well, I mentioned the histone tail that mediates this stacking. What we did is we followed this paper from the Richmond group, where they covalently bonded the stacking nucleosomes by introducing two cysteines in the H4 tail that mediates the stacking, and the H2A protein where this histone tail is supposed to bind. And by introducing cysteines, you can chemically cross-link the nucleosomes, and you can see these stacks here. Well, we did that with our fibers within our magnetic tweezers. And then when you cross-link them, you can see that it takes much more force to rupture our chromatin fibers, right? However, if you do it gently, you can see that the mechanical properties of our fibers, here the greenish one, these are cross-linked. The colored one, so red and purple, they're not cross-linked. Until rupture, the mechanical properties of these fibers are virtually identical. And these are exactly the same molecules. Okay? So these histone tails, they really make up the mechanical properties of the fibers. There's one problem with the solenoid model, that is the linker DNA. The linker DNA needs to sort of connect one nucleosome to the next. And by doing so, DNA needs to be very strongly bent, right? Of course, this is just a model, but I used it to quantify it a little bit. So here I've drawn, say, the linker DNA as it would be in a 30 nanometer fiber, solenoidal fiber, and no way this is going to happen. Right? This is just energetically too expensive. There's another reason why I don't think it happens. That's because we get steric clashes. If you fill it out here in the model of 13 nanometer fiber, it just doesn't fit. Right? Now, the solution for this is rather easy if you think about the FRET experiments. So in the FRET experiments, we've seen that the DNA spontaneously comes off from the histone core. Right? If we allow some of the nucleosomal DNA to come off, we can make a much more gradual curve here. Okay? And now there's still significant energetic penalty to bend the DNA, but it's far less than in the sharp kinked linker histone. You also resolve the steric clashes. You get a beautiful fiber where we can just stretch it up to 10 nanometers per nucleosome without any sterical clashes. Now, of course, this needs to be tested experimentally, and we did that by FRET again. Right? So the hypothesis here would be that in our folded fibers, that the nucleosomal DNA is unwrapped and we wouldn't see any FRET. And that's exactly what we saw. So this is comparing a mononucleosome with a chromatin fiber, and like the experiment by Michael Poirier where he used enzymes to check for accessibility, here we use FRET labels. We see that the folded fiber contains an unwrapped nucleosome, And when we digest that fiber into mononucleosomes again, we recover the thread. Right? So in our folded fibers, part of the nucleosomal DNA is unwrapped, making it more accessible than it used to be. Let me skip, for the sake of time, this part. Now, how is this relevant for the in vivo situation? And of course, the in vivo situation is much more complex. If you think about it in terms of chromatin, the positions of the nucleosomes will not be regularly spaced. They will be fairly disordered. And what's more, many of the histones or the amino acids in the histones will have all kinds of post-translational modifications. The most prominent ones, acetylations of the lysines, which basically cancel the charge. Right? Then, of course, there's dynamic and population variations for every nucleosome. And there's other proteins bound to the nucleosomes. Right? So is anything that we learned from pulling on these perfectly defined model fibers, how is that relevant for real chromatin? So to do that, we simply pulled out a single gene from a yeast nuclear extract. And that's not as trivial as I make it sound, because there's many different fractions of chromatin there. So we had a four-step strategy. Once we went to yeast, because it has a smaller genome, so if you want to pull out a specific gene, our odds are better. Right? The second is that we targeted a multi-copy number gene, and in particular the 18S rDNA gene that has 150 copies. So the odds of pulling out that specific gene increased by 150. And then we developed a sequence-specific probe that only binds to our gene of interest. Right? And what was relevant there is that we needed a probe that does not interfere with the chromatin structure and also does not require chemical cross-linking of all the proteins that are bound on the DNA. Right? And then for the last one, that's a technical one, we just multiplexed our tweezer. So rather than looking at one nucleosome or one bead, we look at 300 at the same time. So this 18S rDNA gene, you may remember from the textbooks, because this gene delivers these beautiful Christmas tree-like structures when you strip these genes of all the proteins and just look at the nucleic acids. Right? Now there's the DNA, that's the long line here, and these side chains, they are individual RNA molecules that are just being transcribed, and as RNA polymerase goes along the gene, the RNA increases, right? What's interesting in this picture is that there's many copies of this gene. Some of them are heavily transcribed, and some of them are not transcribed. And of course, from the chromatin perspective, we'd like to think that these are the genes that are well condensed into chromatin, and these are the genes where chromatin doesn't interfere. But nevertheless, in this spread, all the proteins are stripped. So we're going to do the reverse. We're going to look at these genes, but then with all the proteins in it. And so I mentioned this probe that we developed. It's basically a small nucleic acid hairpin. And one of the features is that we replaced a couple of these bases by a locked nucleic acid. Locked meaning that the ribose has an extra ring that basically stabilizes the base pairing of these bases, and it can increase the melting temperature to up to 5 degrees per nucleotide. So here we make a very strong binding hairpin that we can target to any sequence that we like. Okay, and then we add biotin in this hairpin that we can use to stick to the bead, and then we can basically pull out a gene and flush it into our magnetic tweezer flow cell and do our thing. And it really works. And the way it works is that this probe can invade into the DNA because its affinity is higher than the native DNA. And then we have a strong affinity probe. This is the test. So this is just HindI3 digested E. coli genome. We edit a small amount of targets. And when we pull down the targets using this sequence, we get a very clean sample with none of the genomic DNA. So the multiplex trees, it looks like this. There's many beads, and we all record the height of them, and then we select the right curves. And this is how a pooling curve on native chromatin looks like. And I hope you can see the resemblance. You can see these nice 25 nanometer steps here. You can see a slope here that is in the same order of magnitude as our 601 fibers. And you can see that at some point this slope is gone, and you open up the chromatin fiber. So this looks all very similar to our 601 fiber, right? These are different fibers, six different ones, probably from different yeast cells. And you can see that they sort of follow similar paths, right? So this unfolding mechanism is not just random. It's really embedded in the structure here. You can also see that this fiber unfolding happens below 7 piconewtons, like our 601 fibers. This step happens at slightly lower forces than our 601 fibers. So our nucleosomes are slightly less stable. What would we expect here? Well, based on DNA sequence, we can sort of predict where the nucleosomes end up, right? And when we do that for our gene here, then you can see that there's a couple of positions where nucleosomes don't like to be. There's nucleosome-free regions here, there, there, and there. So overall, if you count this 3,000 base pair DNA fragment, we would expect about 14 nucleosomes, right? If you just follow the average repeat length of nucleosomes in yeast, it's about 167. So we would expect about 18 nucleosomes, right? Now, we can just count the steps in these structures, in these curves here. And here, there's many of them, a couple of hundred of them. We can just count the steps. Step sizes are identically distributed as the 601 fibers. But you can see that there's some fibers that have less nucleosomes. They're more extended at low force. And some of them have more. And if you make a histogram of it, this is what we find, right? So rather heterogeneous chromatin composition, which is not surprising for a heavily transcribed gene. You can see that some of them have about 14, 13 nucleosomes. Some of them come close to the 18, so that's fully occupied. But some of them even have more nucleosomes. Now, that's typically not nucleosomes, but that's probably tetrasomes that would give the same steps. But this is sort of an indication that in vivo, there's not only full nucleosomes, but there's also tetrasomes that help the DNA to condense. Of course, we'd like to think that these genes correspond to the lowly occupied chromatin fibers, and the top ones correspond to the highly occupied fibers, but we're not there yet. I don't dare to say that at this moment. Can we learn more? Well, we can learn more about the chromatin fiber structure by looking more into detail in the unfolding and refolding path. And here you can appreciate that there's levels here in the refolding curve. And these levels should, of course, represent the amount of DNA that's confined when two nucleosomes stack. So we can sort of get the amount of free DNA in these curves, subtract the two levels here, then we get a difference in length when this nucleosome sort of stacks onto the next one, and then we get a nucleosome-nucleosome distance, which makes sense in terms of the average nucleosome repeat length that we expect for our genes. Now, this is all heavily in progress, and we expect much more on learning about the folding of native chromatin fibers and also the difference between different genes. For now, this is what we'll have to do with. So single molecule force spectroscopy on chromatin fibers reveals the structure of these fibers. We can even get out the chirality of these fibers. I didn't have time to show it. The mechanical properties, we can extract interaction energies, and we can even quantify the compositional heterogeneity in real chromatin fibers. This is my last slide, thanking all the people who have helped me with this work, in particular all the students. So this is all of them since I started my group, in both the people that are still there and my great collaborators who helped me with materials and interpretation of the results, and of course my funding. And thank you for your attention.
Very, very beautiful work. Congratulations. I have two questions. One is rather primitive. Could you tell me what is the interaction forces which make the DNA wind along the ribosome? Mm-hmm. That's one. And the second one is that you mentioned that the one base pair is, shows a cooperativity, and the other one is not less cooperative, depending on the positions of the nucleus. Does it mean that there is no specific differences of interaction of the DNA with the ribosome in, by changing the position?
Yep. Yep. Thanks. That's okay. Yep. So first question, what makes the DNA wrap around the histone core? That's of course electrostatics, right? The histones are highly positively charged. The DNA backbone is negatively charged.
Simply electrostatic.
I think that's sufficient. Yep. Mm-hmm. Second question, and I really like that one because I think that really summarizes everything about higher order folding. So nucleosomes like to interact, and depending on the distance between the nucleosomes along the DNA, they may interact with either their neighbors or next neighbors. And the question was, is there any difference in the interaction between the nucleosomes if you neglect the way they get there?
There should be a stacking, any kind of stacking effect.
Right.
You know,
then right.
So, nothing to do with the DNA.
So far we don't have a lot of indication that there's different differences, interactions there. What is different is the linker DNA that may be more twisted and more bent if you change the distance between them. And we measure sort of the net difference in free energy between stacked nucleosomes and free nucleosomes. That includes the actual interaction between the nucleosomes, but it also includes, say, the energetic penalty for bending and twisting the linker DNA.
Is that a part of the reason why you showed some stepwise unfolding force curves? No?
No, so the stepwise unfolding, so here, this is for one nucleosome, this is a stepwise unfolding. The difference between this transition and that transition is here we're in equilibrium. So the unfolding, refolding goes at a time scale faster than our measurement does. Here we're not in equilibrium. So at some point the nucleosome yields and then it yields in a full turn unwrapping. Right, so this makes these steps easy to identify, while here they're sort of hidden in the thermal fluctuations in the extension that are there anyway.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
I always ask you about the linker histone, but this time I'm going to ask you a different question. Is that, you know, you see, you think in order to form the Solana model, right, to sort of alleviate the bending of the DNA comes soft, the nucleus on surface. Could the linker histone aid that by, say, binding on one side, closing two turns, leaving the third, one end free to unwrap?
Right. So it's still a question about the linker histone,
but
I don't mind at all. So the question is, well, there's a fifth histone, the linker histone, that's sort of stabilizing the most condensed structure of chromatin fibers. And how would the linker histone fit into this partially unwrapped nucleosome in the fiber? I think, and I'm also looking at Kurt here, there's still lots of discussion about where the linker histone actually binds. Looking at it from this perspective, it may also help to keep the nucleosome sort of open. Right, as sort of a wedge between the DNA remains to be found out. It's difficult because it's hard to do any, as you know, any structural work on these types of fibers because they are so flexible. Right? We haven't forgotten about linker histones.
Yeah, but it's also interesting that the linker histone is only there in stoichiometric amount when you have longer nucleus on repeat length.
Right.
The short ones, like that has a zigzag model, like in yeast, does not have linker histone.
No.
Right?
No, and there you also don't need much of the unwrapping, right? As the crystal structure and the EM images show.
I really enjoyed your beautiful work. I have a question about how to put this your work in the context of the literature in the last 10 years that I've been going to talks. This question of in vivo fibers and all that. And lately I heard talks, people were saying that there are no ordered fibers, it's disordered, and it's almost like 30 nanometer fiber completely got ruled out. And I'm a theorist, so I'm just sort of saying
I
heard.
No, I mean.
And 10 nanometer is most likely disordered. So just, I'm sure you've sort of thought about how your work, like, do you?
Definitely. So these experiments are, of course, done in vitro under well-defined conditions with, well, at least the first part, with well-ordered fibers. I've only been 15 years in this field, and I know that long before I started, there's already lots of discussion about do they exist, where do they exist, whatever. My take on it is this: nucleosomes like to stack, right? Depending on the linker length, they may stack with different partners. Okay, in vivo the linker length varies. Now we can map nucleosomes, so we know that nucleosomes don't perfectly order or have fixed linker length. It varies quite a bit. Right? Given that and the tendency to stack, you wouldn't expect a regular fiber. Right? Doesn't mean that there's no stacking interactions. It's just that you may have different partners or different structure locally. And if you have a very disordered structure, so far the microscopy techniques are not good enough to resolve individual nucleosomes, including the linker DNA, and follow the path along that. So if you need averaging by one way or another, averaging of images or averaging of diffraction patterns, if there's disorder, basically everything cancels out. Right? So are there very regular structures? Well, I think those experiments show sometimes, sometimes not. Do you expect them? Well, I expect a lot of stacking. Right, and that will sort of define the irregularity. So I don't think there's a contrast there. It's just too simple-minded to think of either or.